certainly not least, to tie up our family series, we're going to deal with the children.
We don't say kids because kids are baby goats. That whole expression, kids, goes back to the ancient use of children in sacrifice ritual. It's an ancient practice that still goes on today. You can find this practice on display in several scriptures, and we're going to look at a couple of those scriptures. But we're going to base this teaching off of a couple of well-known scriptures. Raise up a child in the way that shall go and that shall not depart. And Ephesians chapter 6. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. There's a saying, expression, an old proverb that goes, as a woman goes, so goes the nation. That has a lot to do with the natural influence that a woman has, not only over her man, but over the way that the children go. And the reason that we're seeing such chaos in this world today, aside from the things that the powers that should not be are doing to create a satanic, Luciferian, anti-Christian state of anarchy, is because that we have allowed the children to grow up with very poor stewardship and very poor examples. The children are being raised by children's programming, which is the preferred form of mind control that the powers that should not be produce specifically to seduce the children and to bring them into a subconscious acceptance of a new world order. So we're going to talk about what to allow the children to watch. We're going to look at some words as usual, but first and foremost, we're going to look at a couple of things concerning this agenda to make the children a sacrifice. And it's something that's been done by the kings of the earth, who were first deceived by the fallen angels, the fallen beings, the Nephilim, the offspring of those beings. And they came down here with many different names. They were known by different cultures as different things. You have the Egyptian pantheon. You have the Greek gods of Olympus. You have the Titans, their offspring, which represent the Nephilim. But even if we look in Psalms 2 and 2, we can start with 2 and 1. We do that all the time, because sometimes that's what has to be done. You got to step back one. Dig it. 2 and 1, why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves. This is 2 and 2. Check it out. Listen. Don't just look at me. The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. So there is this agenda by the kings of the earth to get rid of the commoners. And the most important commoners to get rid of is the children of the Most High. We are all children of the Most High. But our offspring, those of us who have offspring, are especially valuable in this spiritual warfare that sometimes takes a physical turn to the enemy. I've said it many times, the Spirit of Detroit statue in downtown Detroit is a representation of Prometheus, who is analogous of Lucifer. In one hand, he holds the light as the light bearer, represented by an energy ball in an industrial city in New York in front of Rockefeller Plaza. You have an actual flame in the golden representation of Prometheus as Lucifer is disguised as in front of that most famous building, of course, named for a very powerful and infamous Illuminati family, Rockefellers. Well, in Detroit, you have the stylized version aimed for the industrial foundation that Detroit was supposed to be built upon. So it's stone. It appears to be a greenish color stone. And in one hand, you find this energy ball representative of the light and representative of the attack on the family and subsequently the family's plight. In the other hand, okay, which is in his right, he looks down with an intense fixed gaze upon the man, the woman, and the child, who Luciferians make the statues, who are holding up their hands in praise as they are targeted by his gaze. And I don't just mean the pink hand agenda, they're targeted by those gaze too. Crowley and his crew, what they used to like to do was to sacrifice the children in the midst of the most heinous acts in their sexual magic rituals. But we can even find examples here in scripture, and I pointed out I highlighted a few to read to you. But first, let's look at how Elijah, the prophet Elijah, a very revered and major prophet, really no minor prophets. Once you made it into this book, you're in the Hall of Fame. Please believe it. But Elijah, we know, called down fire from heaven. We know he put the whoop whoop on Jezebel and the crew. And also, there was something special that the Most High allowed for Elijah to be privy to. The Lord showed Elijah the secret workings of the secret societies of that time. And let's look at that. And that's going to lead us right into watching how this sacrifice of children goes way back. Baby goats were sacrificed. Baby calves were sacrificed. They were considered to be pure, less blemished, as children are considered to be purer, more innocent, and less blemished. And our preferred sacrifices, according to Crowley's writings and others. But let's look here at 1 Kings chapter 18, and we'll start at 36. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. Because remember, they was awful hard-headed. And they continued to turn away until finally they revoked their license, covenant, and contract with being that one sole people of the Almighty. And if you read the book and don't just talk about it and be about it, you'll find it's in there. It's in there like ragu. Let's continue. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. It went from being about the chosen to the elect. It's different when you're chosen for a job than when you're elected for a job. Let's continue. And when all the people saw it,
they fell on their faces and they said, "The Lord, He is the God. The Lord, He is the God." And Elijah said unto them, "Take the prophets of Baal. Let not one of them escape." And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there. He took care of them, put them together, and took them apart. And Elijah said unto Ahab, "Get thee up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain." Ahab was Jezebel's enslaved old dude. People talk a lot about the Jezebel spirit, but not very much about the Ahab spirit. The Ahab spirit is that man of power or of some renown who is often attracted to a woman who has a Jezebel spirit who will bring him down. Have mercy. But he can be brought down because he's got the ways of a clown. You end up having the tears of a clown. All right. So Ahab went up to eat and to drink, because he can be bossed around. And Elijah went up to the top of Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees and said to his servant, "Go up now, look toward the sea." And he went up and looked and said, "There's nothing." And he said, "Go again seven times." And it came to pass at the seventh time that he said, "Behold, there ariseth a little cloud out of the sea like a man's hand." And he said, "Go up, say unto Ahab, prepare thy chariot and get thee down, that the rain stop thee not." Rain, sleet, or snow, get ready to go. And it came to pass in the meanwhile that the heaven was black with clouds and wind, and there was a great rain. And Ahab rode and went to Jezreel. And the hand of the Lord was on Elijah, and he girded up his loins and ran before Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword, all her prophets. She wasn't happy about it. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." So she said, "May the gods slay me unless I make your life like you made my prophets' lives out of here by tomorrow." So she let it be known. She's going to put a hit on him. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life. Have mercy. There's a time to hold them, and a time to fold them, a time to walk away, and a time to run. And came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die. Have mercy. Don't give it up, Elijah. And said, "It is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers." He got distraught. He got a little shook, too. And Elijah wasn't no joke. You'd be shook. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, "Arise and eat." And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals, and a cruse of water at his head. Have mercy. He had a nice cool drink and some bread. And he did eat. I wonder, was it hot water cornbread? Something like hot stone cornbread. And he did eat and drink, and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, "Arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee." Now little did Elijah know, and he was a prophet, but he didn't know. The angel had been sent to him in order to show him the secret place of the secret meeting of the brotherhood of the time, quote unquote. And he arose and did eat and drink. It was going to take him a minute to get there. So he said, you know, you don't want to do too much stepping on an empty stomach. And he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights. Unto Horeb, the mount of God, the mountain of God.
And he came thither unto a cave and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, What doest thou here, Elijah? Again, so when the Lord asks a question, it ain't never because he don't know the answer. It's getting your mind to thinking, trying to get your mind right. And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. This is the chosen. The Israelites did this to the prophets, to their own prophets. Which is why it had to go from the chosen. The idea of the chosen got frozen. And it was the good pleasure of the Lord to select the elect. Have mercy. Who is my mother and who is my brother, but those that do the will of my Father. That's the words of Messiah. Don't argue with me. Argue with the Messiah if you want to. I didn't write the book. I just read it. And he said, Go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains. When they say rent, they mean tear. Sometimes that rent will tear you up. You got to tear them off. And break in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. Elijah wanted to get in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. That's the still small voice that you got to turn down so you can hear when it's around. It's always around. But sometimes you can't hear because you're filling the air with too much of your own sound. Have mercy. Turn down for what? There's your reason. So you can hear the still, small voice of the Lord. It don't come through like Orson Welles talking to Mork from Mork. And it was so, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entering of the cave, stood in the entering in of the cave, the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, What doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I've been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life and take it away. And the Lord said unto him, Go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Hazael, to be king over Syria, Hazael, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. You see the mention of Syria. A lot of people say Assyria. Most people know that's in the scripture. You also find Syria. And no matter what scholars and theologians will tell you, you're not the dullest knife in the drawer. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shalt thou anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. The mighty men of God, at times, they had to pull out that dayah. I didn't write the book. Yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which hath not kissed him. So they have bowed down in front of Baal and kissed the statue, oftentimes on the feet, or at other times, like you see, they do the Pope to this day, who was a representation not only of a false Christ and antichrist by being called the vicar, which means substitute of Christ, but also by being a representation of Baal in the flesh, as much as Michael Obese is a representation of Baphomet. Have mercy. That's right. And I don't want to call his name. You call it if you like it.
Let's continue. Now let's jump here to where he shows, where the Lord shows the secret place of the brotherhood. It's 18 and 37. Let's go back. Well, the Lord opens up the mountain and allows for him to see inside and to see the sacrifices and the abominations being done therein. Okay, but let's move. Let's move forward, and let's look at some of the examples of these sacrifices. Okay, you can find one right here in Elijah in 17. Okay, The first one we're going to look at, we'll find this in 2 Kings 2 Kings chapter 3 verse 26 and 27. Okay. And when the king of Moab saw that the battle was too sore for him, he took with him 700 men that drew swords to break through even unto the king of Edom, but they could not. Then he took his eldest son that should have reigned in his stead and offered him for a burnt offering upon the wall. So here you have the king of Moab who was offering his own, his eldest son, who would be a prince, but who would be next in line to be the king, for a sacrifice, because of the belief that when you sacrifice a child, you are getting much more favor, more bang for your buck, quote unquote, from these demon spirits, that royalty and the lofty minded have consulted with and believed for millennia would not only bring them gifts, but bring them success in battle, allow for them to be exalted in whatever is their field of expertise. We've even talked about, you see the reflection of that even in the fiction of pop culture, which is always based on the facts, especially spiritual facts or facts having to do with scripture. They twist them around, and even in George Lucas's occult-themed sci-fi epic Star Wars, you will find, especially for those who are real Star Wars fans and have read the books and whatnot, you will find the tale of Darth Plagueis, whose father offered him up as a sacrifice to the dark side, a living sacrifice to the dark side, so that the father could receive career advancement. That's the wording used in Wikipedia, and yes, Wikipedia is like the little Star Wars Wikipedia thing. Okay, let me just make sure that Elijah was shown what I thought he was shown. Elijah shown the secret sacrifices. Let me just make sure of that. I would hate to have to do it all over again. Okay. Maybe I misspoke. Maybe that was Elisha. Have mercy. If so, I will start all over again. I really will. I'll leave y'all on my head. Elijah showed the secret sacrifices. Let's see. Okay. Okay, let's move forward. So, okay, so you have that example. And many other examples. Of course, you have it also in 2 Kings chapter 16, 1 through 3, and in Ezekiel 16 and 20. Maybe it's Ezekiel I was thinking of. Lord have mercy. Ezekiel 16 and 20. Let's look. I thought I had it written in the index of my Bible, 16 and 20. Okay, moreover, thou hast taken thy sons and thy daughters, whom thou hast born unto me, thus saith the Lord, and these hast thou sacrificed unto them to be devoured. Is this of thy whoredoms a small matter? So out of all your whoredoms, you think this is lightweight, Janet? The Lord was very upset about that. Jesus said, suffer not the little children to come unto me, when the disciples tried to keep the children from, you know how children do, they was excited to see the Messiah. They really feel the Holy Spirit, especially because of the fact that they are more in tune. Yes, they are. Adults make them less in tune in time, because what adults do is they, over time, they dullen the children's ability to see things by the Spirit and feel things by the Spirit. They begin to tell them that certain things is just your imagination. And then just generally, by the examples of the adults become more fixated with the physical realm around them and the material realm around them as if it is real. Okay? When as a child, you may not know exactly that we're in a matrix, but it tends to be something that a child can easily feel. And so the adults help in the Luciferian agenda, although sometimes unbeknownst to them, you know, not intentionally, but they help in the Luciferian agenda because they help to nullify the children's connection, their natural connection with the place they just came from. Okay? By making the children so worldly bound, they are no heavenly good. Nor should you be so heavenly bound, you're no earthly good. There's a balance. Be in the world, but not of the world. But when you see your children having certain spiritual gifts and certain spiritual leanings and inclinations, you should encourage those things. Of course you should. All right. Now, we wanted to look into the children and the importance of children. Lastly, because I wanted to gather a lot of different information about the children. And I knew that their importance was paramount in the New World Order agenda. And there were, you know, a lot of ways that I could show that to you, but I was just really trying to allow for the Holy Spirit to guide and to put together exactly which things were most relevant to show you that perhaps you've not considered without, again, you know, I don't like to rehashing what others have said. Also, our beloved little sister on this channel, Monet, has provided some interesting information. I'm going to read also what she found and what she had to say. She did an excellent, excellent job. And so I'm going to share that along the way. But even children know, in the little hand clapping and rhyming games that they used to say, they don't say them rhymes no more. They say Lil Wayne rhymes and Plies and Nicki Minaj. But they used to have a little hand clapping rhyme that I would hear them saying outside all the time, you know, with it inside of it, they would say, first comes love, then comes marriage. And if it was a person's name, you know, Tamika or something, they say, then come Tamika with the baby carriage. You know, they start off with, you know, Tamika and Ronnie sitting in the tree, you know, something like that. But anyhow, first comes love, then comes marriage. We talked about love a while back. Then we dealt with marriage. We talked about marriage. Then we even looked into the first relationship to kind of cap the marriage thing off. And then the natural progression of that would be, now we look at the children from the beginning on through to when they're no longer children. So we're going to try to have some fun along the way. We're the only beings, so-called mammals, who produce milk, yet often take the option of feeding our offspring the milk that is designed for another species' offspring. Did you hear me? Does that make any sense at all? Do cats drink dog milk? Hello. Somebody gonna send me a YouTube link of a video. Well, here's a family. They have a dog and they have some cats too. I'm talking about when nature is in order, the natural order of things. But see, you have options. You have sweet freedom. You can do as you will. You have the option of not, you know, for whatever reason, and tell somebody else it's not a self-centered, selfish reason of some kind, or it's not a reason that is connected to you being too worried about what other folks are going to say. But you have an option to reason away the natural usage of the breasts. That's what they're there for. Because of reasons of vanity, okay? Perhaps you're more concerned with how they'll look because, you know, you still are trying to be fixated upon your sexuality. You know, you're self-centered in that way, and that's more important to you than doing what you ought to do for your child to have optimum benefit in what it is fed. And you begin to do that in the physical way. You know, you'll biologically forego allowing your child to be fed the best thing that it can. Then next you will physically forego it, because when under that particular type of pride, vanity, self-centered spirit, you're probably not going to be the kind who's going to get the optimum food sources for the child once it's able to go from milk to meat. Okay, you'll give it McDonald's, you know, McDevils, White Casket, Murder King, okay, satanic churches. And then you'll go from that to not spiritually feeding the child what the child is supposed to have. And it's a two-way street. Where's the father who should be there encouraging you? The baby, you know, I'm more concerned that the baby is given the proper food and not given synthetic milk, okay, than, you know, your breast changing shape. Once you have children, the body changes its shape, okay? It can go from a Coca-Cola bottle to a water bottle because you're not a model. Theoretically, oh, there's going to be some mad folks here, but theoretically, you've used your body in its best years or in its earliest years to attract who was supposed to be your mate. Scripture says he's supposed to be satisfied with the breasts of his youth, of the wife of his youth. So as she becomes the wife of his middle age, as they stay together, again, this is all theoretically how things should be when things are in order. The love that they have for one another should adjust the way his eye gates
reflect her image, and the way his eye gates receive her. You know that. You know love. When you love somebody, you see them differently. You see them without the judgment that you saw him when he was first just trying to hook up. You know, her hips can go from happy to crappy. And, you know, if you are truly in love with that woman, you know, you take on those extra pounds as, hey, you know, that's a package deal, like her and the kids. If she had kids before you got together, it's a package deal. That becomes a package deal also. Same thing for you, fellas. How the woman sees you, you know. You might have had a six-pack, and now it looked like a case of 40s. Well, again, if she loves you, and women are usually better at that than men, because they say men are more visual. But as this society has flipped everything topsy-turvy and inverted the role of women and men and the way that women look at men and men look at women, you know, it's not like it was. But generally, they will say that women are better at that. You know, better at it, you know, because of love, accepting certain things about the man that she loves, even, you know, when he is not as on point as he was when they first got together. So, but see, you know, look at California. The way of Hollyweird, and they have personal trainers, mind you, but the way of Hollyweird has skewed the way that men and women look at one another, and the way that they should look at one another, for the sake of the children, for the sake of love, and unconditional agape love at that. Love's not agape anymore. It's eros. It's conditional. Okay? It can be based upon, you know, simply, you know, and again, you know, not that you want to turn it into no booger bear, but the conditional love that would be the glue that would hold together you two, regardless of what changes the body shape takes, is not what the relationship is founded on anymore, any longer. Because we have allowed for the stars and their practices to be our template for what we expect of our mate. And the expectation is quite often a figment of our imagination and not realistic at all, because it's been shaped by a place that's based on fakes, Hollyweird. Okay, the projections and the images that they put out here by way of sex symbol. A symbol is something that is not a thing, but represents a thing. It represents a thing. It is an idea. It is a picture, an icon of an idea. Okay? And the idea is only that. It's an idea. Just because you have an idea does not mean that it is correct or that it will work. So what we need to do, and what we have to do for the sake of the children, is to get back in order, in alignment. The man should be subject to the Lord. And if the man is subject to the Lord, he's listening and hearing from the Holy Spirit, then the woman follows suit naturally. Shouldn't be a forced thing. If you gotta force it, it's probably not the right fit. Okay? If you gotta force your foot in that gator, that gator ain't for you, player. You need to get another size. So, breast milk is the best milk. The manufacturer of breast milk is the very best. Have mercy. His machine is the best built. So what could really beat breast milk? So you trust the corporations of America who are out to kill the children from the time that they're babies, through everything from abortion to putting lead in children's toys to putting demonic Illuminati
based and laced themes in children's cartoons and things. You trust them? You mean to tell me Judge Joe Brown, you trust them to make something better than breast milk? Have mercy. Well, well, well. The game Goofy Goober has been found. Formula. That's what you give them. Breast milk strengthens the immune system. Formula is a very generic term. It's the two top formulas. Black Sheep had a song. Similac, Similac, child. Make these babies big as all outdoors. And overdeveloped in everything. Okay, now, it's doing that to the physical. What is it doing to the spiritual? Let's look at the word Similac. Let's start there. Okay, the game Goofy Goober side. The exoteric meaning. What we're supposed to all believe, of course, is that we see the combination of an abbreviation of two different words. Semi for similar. Also, semi is kind of like. Semi-pro is not a pro. Okay? Semi is not exactly. And then lac for lactate. But I looked at lac and I said, well, wait a minute. Hello, we ain't talking about Baritz, but lac has to do with not having missing something. Have mercy. Similac, lacking qualities and benefits found in breast milk that are essential for healthy development. And you know the way they hide things in words. So I thought to myself, wow, the exoteric meaning similar and the esoteric meaning semi and lack. Not exactly, and missing or devoid of. Then of course the other one, and I've got to find this because I know I have this noted in my Bible when the Lord showed the secret works of the brotherhood. I wrote 18 and 37, but that wasn't there. Okay. The other one, infamil. And these children, I'm telling you, you know, the agenda to make you demon-possessed goes right along with the agenda to bring forth the fallen ones again through using the CERN super collider and all sorts of portal opening things and things to cause demons to attach to individuals. Okay, we get that, but also to cause us to step into transhumanism. Not only through transvestitism and other isms, robotism, turning into robots and androids, but also Nephilism, to turn you into the fallen ones, Nephilim, who were giant. And there were giants in those days. Well, Jesus said that the last day should be as it was in the days of Noah. It's giants in these days now. You look at some of these children. Have mercy. Out of house and home. Okay. This other guy's in the secret worship of them. Maybe that's what I was looking at too. But that's not it. I'm going to find it. I'm telling you, I'm going to find it. Because I know I saw it. But anyhow. So, infamil. Let's look at that. You have an exoteric meaning. You have an esoteric meaning. In familial. What is it bringing that familiar spirit in? But in familial, as in family. Oh, isn't that cute? Well, wait a minute. Let's look at in.
as a prefix. Sometimes it's a negative connotation to the word in, as in the word ineffective, not effective, insubordinate, not subordinate, you won't listen, you won't sub or be subjected or come under subjection to something, okay? Inadequate, not adequate, and infidel, fidelity meaning truth or true, not true. So in means not or against. In this case, you see the esoteric meaning as in family or against the family. So can't trust them. They're busted. Okay. So what do you give them? What if your wife can't produce breast milk? Well, now see, this would need, you know, this would not even be a question if not for the times that we live in, where there is indeed an agenda to cause us all to surrender our natural roles and even our natural bodily functions over to the enemy so that he can create a whole new society and a whole new race in this place. Have mercy. So yes, that's a valid question. Well, in those cases, you don't have a choice. But how many people fall under that specific and small umbrella? Okay, that small classification and qualification of individuals who actually cannot produce breast milk but are of childbearing age. What has been put in the water? What has been put in the food? We know there are things in the plastic to help to emasculate the male of the species. Well, we have to know that there are things, and I know many of you do know that there are many things, especially in products that are aimed at women, that are truly designed to destroy their womanhood. Just like the products aimed at men. You know, Axe, if you ask me, the way it's aimed at men, okay, I would never use it. Especially when they drop down with the Fallen Angel commercial, even angels will fall commercial. That told me something. You know, they play all sorts of games, you know, with aromancy. And I wondered, you know, I said to myself, now what have they put in this? You know, we mentioned it before. Lady Gaga had a perfume where, according to her own interview, two of the ingredients in the perfume, blood and semen. Well, scientists know that these are things that, on a very subconscious and animalistic level, these are things that help to, and it's strange that for a woman's perfume, it would be semen. I would think it would be something that should attract a man. But again, we know that Lady Gaga is working with a very strong, powerful demon within. But yes, semen and blood on a primal level are supposed to trigger certain subconscious responses and make an attraction happen on the most basic subconscious level of the human mind. So you have to be cautious of the products that you use. If you're younger, you have a chance. Do some research. Find products that are made of the most natural things you can find. And just because it says natural don't mean that it's good. Okay, castoreum in ice cream, in vanilla ice cream, it will say it's a natural ingredient. Well, it is natural. It comes from the beaver's butt. The beaver's natural, and so is his butt. But you wouldn't expect for it to be used in vanilla ice cream, now would you? Well, that's how the game goes. So the word natural is not enough, okay? Feces is natural. That could be in something. So, you know, when you're dealing with a demonic collective,
you got to be smarter than the average bear. You can't just be baby bear square out there. What I've always heard was the best rule of thumb, and not only heard it, but it made sense to me, and I've known it to be true. Every green and leafy herb is for your use. In general, this is the rule. If you can't eat it, don't put it on your baby's body, and don't put it on your body. That's the general rule. That's the general rule. That goes for perfume or anything else. There are essential oils that are attractive, mix well with the body chemistry, and are naturally put here to be fragrant things that the subconscious mind, when it's functioning in order, because again, we're in a society that's out of order, it has made us desire things and think things taste good that really do not. Okay, castoreum, beaver booty oil should not taste good. But again, there's a demonic collective who are all about making evil fair seeming, and the Crowleyan law of reversal, reversing everything. So there are natural things out here that, you know, if you get your taste buds back in alignment, you get your receptors in your nasal cavity back in alignment, you get your eardrums back in alignment, you don't even know what a piano sound like, nor a guitar, nor a saxophone, you don't even care. Ever since Something in My Heart by Michelle Lay, I have abhorred that strong hatred. The sound of a keyboard saxophone, that is the worst sound. It's, you know, it's hard for them computer programmers and technologists to come up with a fake sounding saxophone phone that really sounds real good. That sounds good enough to fool someone who really knows some about music. But all of our senses have been retuned and detuned. We throw it off. Okay? So, if you don't want the babies to suffer in that same way, the children, okay? You want to be especially cautious of what you allow into the eye and the ear gates, of course, but what you put on their skin. Skin is the largest organ on the human body, and it absorbs, okay? It breathes, the pores open up. So you want to find things that come from nature that can be consumed. Peppermint oil can be consumed. I put it in my tea. Have mercy. And sometimes I put it on me. Put a little bit behind my ear. Walk around smelling like a peppermint patty. Chocolate. But yes, so you know. But you know, you find what vibrates properly with you. Okay, so lots of essential oils, you know, you go to a store that specializes in those type of things. If you have a drug emporium in your city, also for those of you that's from the D, off 9 Mile in Woodward, it's a place called the Natural Patch. If you go to the Natural Patch, they have a huge selection and assortment of essential oils. Now, not that you can eat them all, okay, but you'll find a great number of essential oils that you can eat. And hey, what make Lady Gaga or Halle Berry or Mariah Carey or Nicki Minaj able to put together a fragrance? They ain't putting the fragrance together, first of all. But in theory, if they supposed to know what smell good, why don't you? Why they got to tell you what smell good? Same thing for your children. The products that they aim at you, the products that they aim at your ethnicity, the products that they aim at your age group, and the products that they aim at your gender are all used to make those things confused, to turn them backward, or to, in some way or another, destroy them. Okay? So, give the children, give them a better start than some of us had. All right, so that, you know, they can be super bad, because they finna grow up in a whole nother time. So they're gonna need their full body, their full soul, and their full mind. All right, suffer not the children. The gay agenda being taught in school. I wanted to touch on this a little taste, okay? Big shout out to Sister Bourne, who had shared some information about some things going on in her area. But it's happening everywhere, indeed. For instance, LGBTQRS students can come to school wearing something that's supposed to be expressive of their culture, because you know they're finna turn it into, it's just about turned into an ethnicity, okay? Where you have rights based on your sexual preference. What a world. But they can come to school, high school, in booty shorts and belly rings. However, little heterosexual straight students have to adhere to stricter dress code rules. In an environment that is said to be allowing more freedom for one group, the gay and lesbian group, consequently and subsequently, another group is losing its right to speak. So how can it be about giving people rights when in order to give them rights the way that the agenda, the Luciferian agenda, is trying to do, it cuts into the rights of those who may want to express their disagreement with the fact that this is supposed to be something natural. I disagree. I believe, I know that it is unnatural in every way, shape, and form. It is unnatural. But as, you know, as science and society begins to accept something, you know, I'm telling you now, science and society, some of you have such faith in it, you know, they could tell you that drinking lye water will help kill parasites. Okay, and some of you go for it. They could tell you that it was raining quarters and dimes outside, and you'll walk outside with a wheelbarrow. Just because they're saying that something should be accepted because science is saying, you know, well, you know, this is not just a thing of preference. It's something that they can't change. People are eating it up and buying into it. And people, you know, who are not, you know, I bet there's a way to mechanically really tell. But, that, you know, people who are not really a woman trapped in a man's body, or a man trapped in a woman's body, they're just a little freakish and confused, are given an option that take them over the top. Worse than that for grown folks. That's bad enough. But worse than that is the effect on the children. Whereas it was enough to give them the gender roles and choices of, okay, you're a little boy, this is what little boys do. You're a little girl, this is what little girls do. Now they have more choices. And again, it's the death by freedom. The Aldous Huxley versus George Orwell dynamic, Hegelian dialectic, okay, synthesis, thesis, antithesis, synthesis. So you're giving them freedom, sweet freedom, only to jam them up in the end. That's the agenda. Let's look at some more. I was asked what to watch or what to listen to. What do you let the children watch or listen to? Let me find this text. I can tell you what I said to the brother. Okay. Now, why
is it that the preferred form of entertainment for children is animation? Why is that? Well, did you know that in the beginning, animation was for adults? Animation was primarily a way in between movies, or as a person is waiting on a movie to come on, it was a way to slip propaganda in.
Excuse me. I'm sorry.
It's very late. It was a way to slip propaganda in, but I wanted to get this out, to the adults in a way that appeared to be non-threatening. Well, it worked so swell, they said, let's aim it at the children as well. So now you're fixed in your mind, because you're out of your mind. You have it fixed in your mind that, okay, if it's animation, children can look at it. Some of y'all ain't even hip. A child should never see 2 seconds of Family Guy. And The Simpsons ain't no better. The Simpsons were even aimed at children. So, my opinion, no animation. Are there some Christian cartoons or whatnot? Sure there are. But, you know, a lot of the images in those are going to be skewed. But aside from that, let's think Chestnut Checkers. Should you get the children accustomed to animation at all? Once you do that, if you're feeding them Christian cartoons, they will begin to have a taste for animation. I don't think the children should have a taste for animation at all, because there's such a thing as sigil magic. And what animators will often do, and I assure you that you can find this online. I know some of you have seen it. They will make a cartoon character out of phallic symbols, out of breasts, and out of sexual acts, caricatured and stylized, and they will draw a face around the body part in question, or create a little cartoon character, work the shapes of the body parts into their clothing somehow. And what they know and understand, which you do not, is that that is a way to effectively cast a spell. It is called sigil magic, often called symbol magic. Sigil, S-I-G-I-L. But symbol magic, the same basic concept. It's along the lines of sacred geometry when it's used to conjure and open up a portal. But sigil magic is a little different. It's a way of implanting, you know, it's really based on the same concept, but it's a way of implanting within the mind, within the subconscious mind, an image, okay? And there's an idea attached to the image, okay? Because if they draw breasts, the nipples will be erect, or if they draw a phallus, it will be erect. And so the idea is there inside of the drawing. When an artist draws a picture, it's the same as when an artist creates a song. The intent of that artist attaches itself to the art. You feel that? So that's the issue. So animation, no. What about education? Education over animation, because of sigil magic. Educational shows, nature shows, things not meant for children, but just hear me out. Nature shows teaches them about the wonders of nature and God's creation. It gives you an opportunity to give the child an explanation, because as they see the interaction of the cougars and the, you know, the lemurs and the wildebeest and the zebras running across the water trying to get away from alligators or whatever, you can begin to show them certain things about the order of nature,
show them certain things about life and death even. That, believe it or not, that illustration, that's the illustration that you want, not animation. But that illustration of a real life event in creation can be overstood by the child. You underestimate what your children are able to overstand. Cain and Abel was 13 and 15. And it was time for them to get up out the cave and go to work. Okay, and marry and have children. Let's say you don't want to roll with that. You know, in other cultures, 13, 15, when you can begin to biologically, so what, God didn't know what he was doing, the creator was just out of his mind. So you're able to create another life, and, you know, in general, as a boy or as a young man, as an adolescent, you're able to fertilize the egg, but you're also physically strong enough to work. You mean to tell me that you're supposed to wait until you get finished getting your full indoctrination from Masonically created public school systems, or from philanthropist controlled and brotherhood controlled private school systems? You mean to tell me you're supposed to wait until you're 18 or older, okay, to take on these things? And my answer would be, of course you are today, because now you're not as mature in any type of way. Back then they were more mature, they were more sure. This is proof positive that the misconception that we have more educational children's programming today is a lie. It's a misconception that sitting your child in front of Disney or the Cartoon Network is going to make them smarter at doing that work in school is a lie. Those cartoons are designed to sexualize them, to indoctrinate them in occult practices, beliefs, symbolism, to also give them bold ideas about relationships between men and women, to give them bold ideas about God and religion, to give them bold ideas about sexual roles and gender roles, to give them bold ideas, period. So it you know, in my family, it would not be permissible at all. So you just gonna watch nature shows all day? You a game goofy goober in a special way? No. Lots of educational things that you could, if you try, seek and ye shall find. You're so lazy, sitting on your lazy behind. Only thing that can come to your mind is cut on Cartoon Network because it's easy to find. Hello, have mercy. Go find them some programs. Okay? Do some research. You got, what's them things called? You got, Put Locker, and you know, you have ways. You have YouTube. You have ways to entertain. Okay? If you use your brain and don't let your children be off the chain doing what they want to do. And once they start doing certain things, they shall not refrain. Have mercy. Raise up a child in the way they shall go. That's whether you raise them up good or whether you raise them up not so. Give them science programming. Yes, it's science so-called, but not all of it. Again, you have to take good stewardship over the things that come into the children's eyes and ears. I'm talking about from the time they first set eyes on that one-eyed monster that they call the TV, the one-eyed devil. you should be controlling what comes out of that Pandora's box into their minds. But it's too much work for you. It takes too much time. Okay? Next thing you're going to look up, your children are going to be out their mind. I'm not speaking that over you. I'm giving a prognostication based on a realization that you letting too much illustration of animation into their imagination. Have mercy. So, how-to programs, science programs, give you a chance to discuss scientific theory, pros and cons. Okay? They're going to hear it in school. So you watch it with them and make sure they don't be no fool. Okay? You help to shape their overstanding about science. Don't let them be blindly led into putting faith in science and losing all faith in faith. Okay? In the spirit. This is an excellent chance, again, because they're going to ask questions. A child, you know, why is the divine letter the beginning of the divine name? I am. Okay, the Yod in Hebrew. Child can say why till the cows come home. And every time you give them an answer, they can ask you another why. Because why is the true unknown. Let's continue on. And how-to programs. That sounds weird, don't it? Children learn fast and pick up skills before we believe they can. As soon as you put a remote control or a video game controller in their hand, you see they overstand. So why not apply it to something else instead of just when they plan? What is your plan? Plan your work and work your plan. Let them see how things are built. Let them see how things are made. Let them see skills and talents. Their little brains are so eager for knowledge. It's like a sponge. True, you've heard that experience before. Expression before. I know you have, because I have too. But they soak up everything, especially the things that you say and do. Around that age, you know, when they're very young, as young as one or two or less, they can, you know, only so many months old, they can pick up as many languages as you can put down. So that's proof positive, okay, that you are allowing your children to be underachievers. Have mercy. And underbelievers. Okay? Raise up a child in the way they should go and they shall not depart. What you teach them now, consciously or subconsciously, knowingly or unknowingly, will stay with them in their mind, soul, and heart for a lifetime. I know this for a fact. I've told you the story of when I looked at the can of Red Devil ham. I couldn't have been but 5 or 6 because that was the ages I was at this house. And my mama was standing there at the stove cooking my breakfast. And I looked at the can and I saw the devil on the can. I knew it was the devil. I don't know how. But I knew he was the bad guy and God was the good guy. Somebody must have explained that to me. And it stuck with me. This is 36 years ago. And I remember. I said, Ma, is there such thing as a God? She turned to me and she said, I don't know, but you should find out for yourself. And that set me on my journey. The things you tell a child, and that was such a profound moment. I can see, I can picture it in my mind's eye. Before I closed my eyes just then, I could see it. So it is true. Okay? I also know the impartations that I've made to younger family members. Okay, when I was going through my phases and learning about all sorts of things. Okay? Egypt and different things of that nature. Different family members I told those things to. They're still manifesting evidence that affected them to this day. Okay? and not always in a negative way. You know, I put so much emphasis on you're able to do whatever you can put your mind to for one family member that they just about do that. Okay? You know, of course now, you know, if I had it to do over again, I would put in there also to do all things through Christ that strengthens you. But it's to show you that you may plant a seed, but you ain't always going to water it and nurture it and give it everything it needs. Sometimes all you can do, or all you're supposed to do, is to plant the seed. And I planted that particular seed of knowledge, information, whatever. And for a minute, I thought all was lost. I said, you know, because they had doubts about the Messiah. And I did the best I could to show them what I knew after I knew it was true. Gave it a year or two, looked around, and believe me, they're safe and sound, okay, in the ministry as well. So let's just take that as evidence from practical application of a theory, of an idea. And that idea is, no matter what age a child is, or what age society says a child has to be to begin to learn, and we're going to look at some proof positive about that in 1 second. It's a lie. My Auntie Joyce, God rest and bless her loving soul, she was the one who always tried to teach me something about the scripture, even when I was in my Dr. York stuff. And I knew that, you know, she had something special. She would see visions, real vivid visions, to where, you know, she had that gift so tough, folks thought she was crazy. Some folks did. I knew she wasn't crazy. But she would claim that she would hear me talk, and she could hold conversations with me way before everybody else said I was talking. But she was the one who would, the one person who would have a belief that it could be done, and would not be bound by what science says about it. So, hear me now, believe me later, but you won't doubt it. Don't doubt it. Be about it or be without it. Talk to the children. You know, they say that when a child is in the womb, if you play certain intelligence building music, it's different, okay, than if you let the local trash urban hip hop radio station play all day long with all that ignorant stuff. Then you wonder why your child come out and he can't keep his fingers out his nose. Have mercy. What you teach them now, consciously or subconsciously, knowingly or unknowingly, will stay with them for a lifetime. Milk for the physical and emotional. Meat for the mental and spiritual. Certain emotional concepts, certain ones, and physical concepts, and physical realities, have to come along slowly. Okay? They're only going to develop physically so fast. You understand? Overstand? They will only be able to overstand and express certain emotions so fast, because they're going to have to experience some things that's different. Give them meat for those things. Excuse me, give them milk for those things. You give them meat for the mental and the spiritual aspects of things, because they can take it. By golly, they're more spiritually connected than you. Me too. Because we are adults, and our ideas have been shaped by society, by pop culture, by experience, by peer pressure, by contemporary beliefs, some of the things that's accepted today were not accepted before, as society begins to wither away and civilization degrades. But people will call it having more freedoms. Okay. As we move forward and we watch society get iller and iller, it seems like that everything is on a downhill slope, but nope. Children, what the enemy makes for bad, God turns around for good. Children are ready for more than ever. They're mentally ready for more than ever. Don't keep them in a state of arrested development because you lazy or crazy. Have mercy. Feed them meat. They can take as much mentally and spiritually as you can feed them. Can't beat them. And see, we have become dumbed down. You and I, we're adults. Our ability to tap into the Holy Spirit and to see things, not only with the flesh eyes. Remember how Adam and Eve, Adam was very disgusted how his eyes were now flesh. He could not behold the things that he once seen. He was childlike, wasn't he? That's what we're talking about. So challenge them, The more you challenge a child, the further that child can go. A child, and I don't, the type of challenge I mean. Give them some meat, okay? I remember being told, don't talk no baby talk to no baby. The baby is learning how to talk from you. That's what some of these kids now, they sound like Porky Pig. Have mercy. I used to stutter, I can talk about it. Because the conversation that they're hearing when they're in their formative years of being able to speak isn't very beneficial to them having a good grasp of the English language. Hello? Anybody there? So you speak to the children, Well, that's going to make them too mature. Hey, I just look like this. Speak to the children. Okay, in clear, precise, and concise language. Give them the opportunity to be able to come down. Okay, some of these kids are so down with everything, pop culture say, because mom and daddy was too, and they thought it was all okay. It was cute for them to be a little thug, okay, to be a little reflection of something they see on pop culture. Okay, pop culture want the children to be dumb. It's dumb. It's a dumbing down of society. Have you ever seen Idiocracy by Mike, I believe his name was Mike Judge, the guys behind the Beavis and Butthead movies, made a real live-action movie about how in the future, a guy goes to sleep, wakes up, jumps in a time machine, something, and he ends up in the future. And as he goes through the future, he begins to see how people get stupider and stupider. So stupid to where an ignorant pro wrestler played by Terry Crews end up being the president. And it's odd and ironic. It was one of the black president depictions that I believe was predictive programming, because it was the dumbing down of America that got old Beezy to slip through the cracks there. We didn't ask the questions like a child asks. A child is sharp in trying to build his body of knowledge. He asks why a million times. We didn't even ask who. Who is this guy? Why? Why now a quote-unquote black president? And that's a lie. But anyhow, you get my drift, okay? Speak to the children. Raise them up in the way they shall go. give them more. Not more material. You know, they got more materials. They got more shoes. They got more clothes. They got more gadgets to help keep them bound to technology. Good job. But they know less than ever before. Yeah, they do. They got to Google everything. We knew phone numbers. I had so many people's phone numbers in my mind when I was 18, 19. Earlier than that. But I know by that time, I know my catalog of phone numbers, excuse me, that I had mentally logged had to be ridiculous. Okay. Is memory not part of
concentration and learning? I just look like this. So, you know, you've empowered them by giving them more sweet freedom. So Lucifer can shine his light on them. You're giving them too much sweet freedom. Have mercy. Evolution is contrived. You know I'm a creationist. Yet, like all lies, evolution is even built upon a firm foundation of a particular truth. What truth is that? Brother Unplugem. Check it out. Dig it. Every generation, because of education and information being revealed more and more as we enter and go further into the days of revelation, every generation gets increasingly able to digest and increasingly capable of digesting larger amounts of knowledge. This is a double-edged sword. Video games, cell phone usage, remote controls, automatic tech, all have a dual application in the development of children. It can be used to destroy them, cause them to be antisocial, not understand how to interact or play well with other kids, make them distant with you as a family member, make them look at life as all about obtaining and gaining things, and make them dumb as a box of rocks. Or you can look at that example being how the children are more able to manage one part of life than ever before. And you can say, well, if they can do this part, I'll do the other part and make sure that they are fully laced up that much more. So they're being taught how to function in society the way that society wants them to function. Okay? But peep game and ensure that they're not unequally yoked mentally, spiritually, emotionally, or physically. Because the same way they have all the gadgets that they think they need, none of which they need. They can't remember no phone numbers and they can't read. They can't spell. Some of them have never looked at a book as well. They can get everything from Google. Everything. Science reports. I remember when science reports stopped being done by books. It blew my mind. Science reports, English reports, the whole nine. Okay? So the world that we live in, you know, it's not designed for increased survival of the commoner. It's designed to increase the death, mental, spiritual, physical, and emotional of the commoner. So you have to balance off. When your child is so well versed in society and what society say, you better balance that thing off. Because guess what? You can't serve two masters. For you will love one and hate the other. I didn't write the book. I just read it. The children will be fed more information as times change in this information age. and civilization becomes more quote-unquote advanced. Less is hidden than in the days of way back when children were to be seen and not heard. They used to hide everything. I tell you, I was like Indiana Jones in the Temple of Doom, seeking for treasure. Couldn't wait for somebody to leave the house and leave me there by myself. I could find guns and dirty books, weed seeds. Just, you know, so I could find things and find out things, because they certain things, you know. Well, you too young to know that, or it's none of your business. And as a child, you've been supposed to push that when you was told that by an adult. Okay? It's none of your business. Nowadays, these children are bossy. And scripture says that in the last days, the parents should be afraid of the children. Can you imagine how ludicrous that sounded 50 years ago when people would read that? Now it makes a lot of sense, don't it? Well, so it behooves a believing parent to be more attentive to what is being fed to the little ones. The ear gates and eye gates of children are especially sensitive now that they are being fed more mature / adult sounds and sights, and being given more leeway, leniency, and children's rights. You have to be more protective, not less effective, when it comes to being protective of their inherent innocence. The adversary desires to cause them to lose their mental innocence, their emotional innocence, their verbal innocence, and finally, their physical innocence. If the scripture is true and the devil is prince of this world, how are you, as a parent, doing your child a favor by being less of a disciplinarian and more of a friend, someone they do not necessarily fear or have to respect? It's a friend. Mom put the fear of God in me. She could have a, she had a look. I knew what was coming next if I kept on. Pow! Oh no, your mother hit you. Thank God she did. You need to hit yourn. You need to hit them for things you ain't caught them doing yet. Just go hit them right now. Just go hit them. But they'll call CPS on you, Child Protective Services. They'll call the people on you. They have, now they've been given rights. Children have rights. Transvestites have rights. Parents have less rights. And so do heterosexuals. This world has been flipped upside down. Whew. Grandmas and granddaddies are lax enough. They offer the children that dose of liberty that they need. And the wisdom of the elders, grandma and granddaddy, should make those elders more capable of knowing how to manage the liberty that they give the grandbabies and establish necessary boundaries. Spare the rod, spoil the child. You set the boundaries and the rules, and at least subconsciously, children want you to and respect you for establishing your authority, which they will remember and pass on to their own children. The way of today, offering sweet freedom beyond the ability and thinking of a child, beyond their ability to be responsible for that sweet freedom, because they have a child like mine. That way of today is a way that will teach irresponsibility, instill a do as thou will mentality, and eventually lead to a society bubbling with the potentially explosive spirit of rebellion and inevitable anarchy. That's the bottom line, to create this chaos. Okay? Pray the ancestral demons away for the youngest children and infants. The mouth is a wellspring of life. By your words you will be justified. By your words you will be condemned. Sticks and stones may hurt your bones, but words can cut like a knife.
Watch the words that you say and use your words to cut certain things away, such as family and generational curses. From Dr. Bree Keaton's book, Stripes, Nails, Thorns, and the Blood, Family and Generational Curses, because she is a mother and gave a very interesting testimony here regarding schooling of children and the occult. I wanted to share that with you. She says in chapter 15, I will now recount a story about our local public elementary school teaching witchcraft to the fifth graders. Did you hear me? One of the parents, we'll call her Linda, I had alerted, asked me for prayer and help with her own situation. I went to her home and immediately sensed that it was infested with demons. Now, Dr. Keaton is quite anointed. It's in the wee hours. I got a couple more for y'all too, so. Linda was trembling with fear, but her spirit was open to the Lord because I had sent my heart and soul surrender cassette home with her son. It was obviously something that Dr. Keaton had already done. And she had played it for 3 days before my arrival. She makes music as well too, and it's anointed. This helped to prepare the ground and began to loose her mind from satanic deception. The strongholds were great in her life because her mother had given her to the devil and cursed her as a small child, repeatedly abused her, attempted to kill her, and told her that she was hated and unwanted. Now, you remember we've talked about that a number of times in the making and breaking contracts video. I also mentioned that people do that. People offer their children to the enemy, formally. Okay. The abuse shattered her personality into fragments. How MK Ultra is accomplished, or Project Monarch, Mind Control Slaves, creating an increasing life and death struggle that made it nearly impossible to function normally. There were a number of triggers put in place to control her and cause extreme fear and anxiety, also serving to make her helpless and dependent on the parents' whims. The mother had selected and given her to her husband as his slave. As soon as they were married, he quit working, though he was healthy and strong and fully capable of providing. He made Linda support the family. Linda's family had tried to have her committed because she soon became unable to work. She was living in a home across the street from and owned by her mother. Her husband was currently living elsewhere, deep in pornography. He sometimes forced the children to watch porn when they visited, while he lay in bed with strange women. He would come over frequently to bully Linda with the full blessing of her mother. I spent over 7 hours casting out demons. One was sitting on her chest, choking her. I told her to make it go. She began to sob and ask, "What will I do?" Again, you have the power and authority to work out your own soul salvation. And a person that can be active in deliverance will be delivered more easily. They've been with me so long, I won't know how to act," she said. Finally, she told it she didn't want it anymore, and I commanded it to leave in Jesus' name. We both watched it go out the window. I led her and her children to the Lord. She renounced any involvement with the occult and repented for her sin. I broke the curses spoken against her and, at her request, filled a garbage bag full of objects of worship to demon gods, talismans from the psychic network, jewelry, statues, posters, a dream catcher, hand-carved voodoo idols, anything she or her children were using as a point of contact with demons. I broke the power of each object off her and the children. We anointed all doorways, windows, pillows, beds, and people with oil, and drew the bloodline of Jesus at all entrances.
Before I left, I taught her how to stand against the imminent attack of Satan in Jesus' name and wrote down some instructions. When I left, she begged me to take the garbage bag to a dumpster, because if we had set it out on the curb, she said she would not be strong enough to resist bringing it back in. You hear me, Ken? Kenfolk? She called the next day praising God for her glorious newfound freedom. She rejoiced that she had used Jesus' name and made the demons stay away. Monday, I began receiving threats from her relatives for helping her and for throwing away the idols. Linda called Monday evening and told me the bizarre events of the day. The one object she was unwilling to part with was the most critical of all. She related the story of how a satanic priest had come to her home and cursed a large mirror on the wall. Mirror, mirror, on the wall. The mirror immediately developed a fault in the center, like a fault line. Demons came and went through this portal. We've talked about that before, have we not? Mirror as a portal, house of mirrors, or a fun house and a carnival. Michael Jackson's room of mirrors, Candyman, and Bloody Mary, saying those words in the mirror three times, and a demonic entity manifests. Let's continue. The mirror immediately developed a fault in the center. Demons came and went through this portal. She had also told me she feared she might be pregnant by her abusive husband from whom she was separated. The divorce would be final in 2 weeks. She had swelled up and suddenly gained 20 pounds, but the doctor told her that morning she was not pregnant. Linda came home and stood in front of the mirror, laying hands on her belly, pushing hard and shouting, "Come out in Jesus' name." Blood gushed out, and she saw three demons leave her and go into the mirror. Her husband, who was using her as a chalice, what a chalice is, that's what they be calling a pimp cup, what Little John and different ones would have, and what you see in the party stores and liquor stores, that's a chalice. It is a holder of liquid, generally used in ceremony and ritual to hold the blood in the Catholic communion ceremony. They drink the wine from a chalice. Her husband, who was using her as a chalice, was desperately attempting to regain control of her through sorcery, impregnating her with demons to prevent the divorce. Human beings can be impregnated with demons. I know this for a fact. I know someone who this happened to. It's real. She asked me what to do. I instructed her to get some oil, anoint the mirror, and break the power of the gateway or portal in Jesus' name. Then I told her to bind up the door to the demonic realm in the mirror, close it, and seal it by binding Jesus' blood to the mirror. I held the phone and heard her carrying out these instructions. Then I advised her to get rid of the mirror. She was able to return to work, but much ground was lost when the owners of the house, her parents, and her husband gained re-entry and brought many of the demons back with them. Demons respect authority and ownership. If possible, it is best to minister solely on property that is holy or sanctified. I have resolved to ascertain who owns the property before beginning deliverance sessions in the future. Word curses. Your situation may not be as dramatic as Linda's, but word curses are just as damaging. Watch what you say to these children, such as, "You'll never amount to anything. You're lazy and stupid, just like your father. Grandma had breast cancer. Mother had it, so I'll probably have it too. You're too old, too young, too poor, too fat, too short, too tall, etc." The list of possible curses is as endless as the people who make them. They bring destruction to lives and must be broken in Jesus' name, canceled,
and sealed by the blood of the Lamb. Generational curses. There are many who are being overcome by generational curses. These curses come down from relatives living and dead who sinned against God or were cursed by others. All right? We say living and dead because living relatives, of course, can put a generational curse on you. But the relatives that have passed, things that the enemy assigned to them, demons that were assigned to them and took them out the game, will continue to go down the bloodline and attempt to take you out the same. They bring destructions to lives that must be broken in Jesus' name, canceled and sealed by the blood of the Lamb. Okay, there are many who are being overcome by generational curses. These curses come down from relatives living and dead who sinned against God or were cursed by others. It manifests in a family history of diseases, mental illness, and in a spirit of bondage to things such as liquor, gambling, lust, divination, cigarettes, etc. It may manifest in a propensity to anger, child or wife abuse, or clairvoyance. That's right. A spirit of divination that attaches itself to a family bloodline down through the generations has the right to be there if any ancestor practiced witchcraft. That's right. Clair for clear, voyance for voyeur, to watch, to be able to watch clearly or see clearly is what it means, clear sight or clear watching. The problem with that, as with telepathy, is that in order to trick you into being comfortable with allowing them to be there, demon spirits can give you the appearance of having those powers only so that you desire those powers, which is good enough for the accuser to take you to court and say you desire the source of the powers, therefore and hitherto with legalistic. Okay, the spirit, meaning the demon spirit, this spirit, divination, is not a wonderful gift like the Hollywood movies teach, but a terrible curse. The strongholds that are nurtured and expanded through demonic attachments must be broken. In my case, since I'm adopted, it had to be done in both my birth parents and adoptive parents' maternal and paternal bloodlines. And I'm going to add, if you're praying a prayer to break generational curses, it's legalistic to break the curse, because it was a contract made with the devil. The devil is into and in the details. So if it's an adopted person, sometimes what you have to do, what I have had to do, and if it's a married person, is you have to use the names that applied to them when the curse, when the contract with the enemy was put into effect. That's right. It's real deal Holyfield, heavyweight champion. All right. You got that right. All right. I know you did. The deaf and dumb spirit that Jesus cast out was in the boy because of the father's sin of unbelief, Matthew 17 and 21. This curse was broken when the father repented. Then Jesus cast out the demon out of the boy and commanded it not to return. This deliverance was unique in two ways. It's the only instance in Scripture where the demon was disarmed before being cast out and was forbidden to return. Remember this when dealing with generational curses and the deaf and dumb spirit. Because sometimes what the Holy Spirit will put in my mind is not to use the terminology. You know, I always want to do it myself in the natural, but sometimes I'm told not to use the terminology forbidden to return. Because if that individual, you know, that, you know, I can't operate in a
witchcraft spirit, a control spirit, if that individual invites that demon spirit back in, it's got every right to be there. So that's the issue with that. But again, that's an excellent example of when it is permissible to do so. Matthew 17:21, when the Father says, Lord, help us, or help me of my unbelief. Most generational curses should be broken back to the third and fourth generation. The references to curses that go back to third and fourth generation for iniquity and transgression are Exodus chapter 20, verse 5, Exodus chapter 34, verse 7, Numbers 14 and 18, and Deuteronomy 5 and 9. The curse of illegitimacy that goes back to the 10th generation, that's right, is referred to in Deuteronomy 23 and 2. Repenting for sins of forefathers and for the nation, strongholds that have people in their grip through bloodlines must be broken. We break them off by faith, using the name of Jesus and pleading his blood. Do this with each ancestor on both sides, beginning with the appropriate generation and working your way to the first. Often God will reveal specific sins as you move through this process. Absolutely. He will put it in your mind what to pray for. You just begin to walk, and you know that he's going to tell you which way to turn. So you just start walking, start talking. Okay. Repenting for sins of forefathers and for the nation. Okay. There might be an ancestor on your mother's side who practiced witchcraft. Stop at this generation and break the curse in Jesus' name. Stand in the gap as if it was you who sinned. Then forbid the evil spirit to return, because the open door to curses has been closed. The claws have to be proper. Excellent wording. Very contractually sound. Seal it with the blood of Jesus. Then proceed carefully, expecting more revelation, because the Lord will guide you every step of the way, and he will give you what to say. I've seen people rush through this process, counting down as fast as they can, and I know they mean well. However, it is much more compassionate and effectual to move slowly, allowing the Holy Spirit to speak. Have mercy. The following scriptures are powerful and effectual for repentance. Let thine ear now be attentive, and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night, for the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned, and in the authority of the name of Jesus, by his stripes, by the nails, by the thorns, and by his blood, Heavenly Father, I ask that you break all generational curses that have come down my bloodline, and that have come down the bloodlines of any who are watching and listening to the third and fourth generation, and where it's applicable to the 10th generation. And I ask this in the authority of the name of Jesus. We touch in agreement, and by his stripes, nails, thorns, and the blood, we are healed. The curses are broken. We've decreed it. And we believe it, and it is so. O Lord, according to all thy righteousness, I beseech thee, let thine anger and thy fury. Oh, that was Nehemiah 1 and 6, by the way. O Lord, according to all thy righteousness, I beseech thee, let thine anger and thy fury be turned away from thy city Jerusalem, thy holy mountain. Because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and thy people have become a reproach to all that are about us. Now therefore, O our God, hear the prayer and his supplications, and cause thy face to shine upon thy sanctuary that is desolate, for the Lord's sake. For we do not present our supplications before thee for our righteousness, but for thy great mercies, O Lord. Hear, O Lord, forgive, O Lord, hearken and do. Defer not for thine own sake, O my God, for thy city and thy people are called by thy name. Daniel chapter 9, verses 16 through 20,
And lastly, no, two more. If any man see his brother sin, a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. 1 John chapter 5 and 16. Did you get it? If any man see his brother sin, a sin which is not unto death, meaning a sin that you don't get capital punishment for, okay, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. Okay? Got it. Whatsoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them, and whatsoever sins ye retain, they are retained. John 20 and 23. Other scriptures for repentance are Leviticus 26, 39 through 42, Nehemiah 9, 1 through 4, Jeremiah 3, 24 through 25, then chapter 14 and 20. 7 quick points on getting free. Confess sins involving the occult. Confess any abortions. Okay, when I was a young man aspiring to get into the business, I was party, and in a couple of cases, the influence to abortion. And I've asked for repentance. I've asked for forgiveness, and I've repented more than once to the Lord. But it says confession is good for the soul, and I regret that now. You know, having none, isn't that interesting? But that was in my folly and in my foolishness of youth, and chasing the dream and not wanting to be bogged down. Okay, again, that's going back to that, going against the natural use and function of things that we started off the video with, talking about the breast. That's what breast is for. What you think your Johnson is for? To create and bring life into this world. Okay, which consequently, you get a reward of pleasure for doing that. Beyond that, you're out of bounds. Some kind of way. You want to get back in bounds. So you pray. You ask the Lord about how to do just that this day. Number 2, repent and ask God's forgiveness. Number 3, break the power of each stronghold over your mind in Jesus' name. Number 4, plead the blood of Jesus over each instance. Number 5, cast out any familiar spirits, generational demons, divination, or witchcraft that may be operating. Number 6, if you believe you are a victim of word curses, known ones you made against yourself and ones you know others have made against you, and unknown, A, break all word curses against you in Jesus' name, render them null and void. Listen to me now. B, somebody heard that. Break off and renounce all psychic power, soul power. You're talking about James Brown. And satanic power that has been arrayed against you. And C, cancel their assignments. D, declare that the blood of Jesus is against these evil curses and bind the blood of Jesus to yourself. And finally, number 7, for completion, true completion in the spirit, forbid these demons to return once the curses are broken. You have the right to do that. All right? And just a couple of healing scriptures for you to jot down. The by whose stripes you were healed. 1 Peter 2 and 24. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved, for thou art my praise. Jeremiah 17 and 14. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Romans chapter 8. Verse 2. Remember, your mouth is a wellspring of life. Words are health to the flesh. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, not just for you, but for the little ones, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. The lips of the wise shall preserve them, Proverbs 14:3. A gentle tongue with its healing power is a tree of life, but willful contrariness in it breaks down the spirit. Proverbs 15:4 in the Amplified Version. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness thereof is a breach in the spirit. The mouth of a righteous man is a well of life, Proverbs 10:11. And the breach in the spirit one is Proverbs 15:4. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. So the words that you say shape your reality, but of course also the children who cannot escape your reality. So watch what you're saying around them. You cussing, you kicking up dust, and still ain't saying nothing. Okay, we'll look at this quickly and then be out of here. We should be done, I guess, about 2:05. I thank you again for coming in. Okay. Alright, I still was trying to find that one particular scripture where the Lord showed the prophet the secret activities of the other Israelites. I believe it was Elisha, let's see. Takes him down to a cave and shows him. Oh, Lord have mercy. I cannot believe. Oh, man. I'm so upset about that. Because I know I had that highlighted and I can't see it. I can't find it. That's crazy. But okay. Let's look at real quick. Babies in the Holy Spirit. Noted at the top of the page. This was the place, this was the spot right here where the Lord opened up. I think he took him up in a mountain, and the Lord opened up the wall and showed him how they were sacrificing and worshiping idols. We got 17:9. And the children of Israel did secretly those things which were not right against the Lord their God, and they built them high places in all their cities, from the tower of the watchman to the fenced city, and they set them up images and groves in every high hill and under every green tree, and there they burnt incense in all the high places, as did the heathen whom the Lord carried away before them, and wrought wicked things to provoke the Lord to anger. For they served idols, whereof the Lord had said unto them, ye shall not do this thing. Yet the Lord testified against Israel and against Judah by all the prophets and by all the seers, saying, turn ye from your evil ways, and keep my commandments and my statutes according to all the law which I commanded your fathers, and which I sent you by my servants the prophets. Notwithstanding, they would not hear, but hardened their necks, like to the neck of their fathers, that did not believe in the Lord their God. And there again is an example. All praise due to the true and living God. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. There is another example of the ancestral curse. It was passed down because the fathers were stiff-necked and hard-headed first. The spirit of rebellion. For witchcraft is as the spirit of rebellion. Did you know know that? They make you a witch by default, a warlock too. All right. You may want to look at, there's a video on YouTube, a baby at church gets the Holy Spirit. Just type that in, you'll find it. And it's a very good video to watch, just to, you know, sometimes we got a lot of negativity into our eye gates, looking up, you know, and being aware of the devices of the enemy. You know, sometimes we need to be wowed by the wonders and devices of the Lord. And this little baby is just so sincerely and clearly feeling the Holy Spirit. And over in the corner of the room, it appears to be a manifestation of one of the angelic hosts there in the house, pleased with the perfect praise of a child, all right, out of the mouths of babes. All right, let's check it out. Okay. The angel informs Zechariah that his wife Elizabeth, though advanced in years, will bear him a son who will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. Again, now this portion of the reading we're going to end with, again, it's from our little sister Monet. Support her. She's one of the sharper knives in the drawer, okay, and she's yet still learning and growing. Gabriel tells Mary that she will conceive a son, Jesus, who will be called the Son of the Most High. So predestination from the womb, exhibited and exemplified by the Messiah, who was holy God and holy man. Let's look forward and deeper into it if we can. A crucial event that determines whether the embryo will develop into a male or female occurs in the second half of week 6, at only 40 days after fertilization. Electrical waves, as measured by the EEG, can be recorded from the baby's brain, indicating brain functioning. 49 days after conception, magic happens, quote unquote. It is on this 49th day, 9, 18, 27, 36, and 13. Again, 13, 3 sixes, not the devil's creation. He has taken those things and made them his own. But he's a stealer, he's a biter. He's not a creator. It is on this 49th day when we sexually diversify, becoming either male or female. Scientists say that a person's pineal gland is fully formed 49 days after conception as well. The human pineal gland becomes visible in the developing fetus at 7 weeks or 49 days after conception. The pineal gland is the gland so often referred to in New Age as the third eye. There's a movie called From Beyond, if you can find it. Excuse me. I believe it's either late 80s or early 90s. Okay. And I want to say it's Lovecraft or H.G. Wells, but it was one of my favorite sci-fi slash horror movies. I'm not going to tell you much about it, except a scientist has figured out that this gland is the quote-unquote third eye to see into other dimensions with. So he develops ways to strengthen his. Okay, and that's when the fun and the nightmare begins. From Beyond. Okay, that's what the movie was called. Yep. Okay. It is the seat of the soul. Okay, she writes. Also note that anyone's pineal gland can be calcified. Of great interest to me was finding out that this is nearly exactly the moment in which one can clearly see the first indication of male or female gender. Before this time,
the sex of the fetus is indeterminate or unknown. Until the fetus is 40 days old, it is still called a drop, since it is indeterminate whether it will be a boy or a girl. When the drop of semen remains in the womb for 40 or 50 days or 40 nights, the angel comes and says, and again, you know, it was when the drop of, you know, the angel comes and says, "My Lord, will he be good or evil?" And both these things would be written. Then the angel says, pardon me, "My Lord, would he be made, excuse me, would he be male or female?" And both these things are written. "And his deeds and actions, his death, his livelihood, these are also recorded. Then his document of destiny is rolled, and there is no addition to and subtraction from it." The Gemara states that just like the Torah was given in 40 days, so too the Neshama is created in 40 days, Neshama Nasara. The Gemara in Nida 16b talks about at the time of conception, 40 days before the fetus takes shape, that an angel takes a drop from conception and brings it to Hashem, the name. And it is at that moment, in that time, that it is decided who he is going to marry, whether he'll be rich, what kind of house he'll have, etc. There are also passages in the Bible that can be interpreted to support the 49 days after conception. Now, I have certain views on predestination, and without giving it too much complication, Jesus exemplified our limited knowledge as men when he said, "No man knoweth the day or the hour, not even the Son, but only the Father." Again, there was a separation that was made voluntarily because one of the Lord's purposes was to be able to experience our fallibility. Okay, and you know, it's real. Excuse me. So yes. We can change and shape what occurs only so much, because you can't surprise the Lord. He knows every move that you're going to make, ever made, and that you are making. So, I'm for that. I'm sorry. Okay. In Daniel chapter 9, 25 through 27, "Know therefore and understand that from the going commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem until the Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks. Pentecost is 49 days after Easter. And Pentecost is the day when the elders in the temple were surprised by a gusting wind, when suddenly tongues of fire came down and rested upon their heads. In other words, their crown was illuminated. The pineal gland was functioning, and the Spirit came down unto man." This is obviously symbolic for 49 days after the literal conception, when the Spirit literally descends down unto us and gives us our soul. Okay. Her conclusion, what she's found from reading about the pineal gland in babies, is that while babies are still very young and don't have the ability to talk or communicate properly yet, they still have the ability to use their soul. Since the soul is developed while in the womb of the mother, they can use their soul to the best of their ability because they're very sensitive and can feel things. The Holy Spirit is strong and can be held and can be felt by babies more so than adults, because their soul has not been altered or calcified by means of chemicals.
poisons, vaccines, poor nutrition, etc. That's why breast milk helps babies a lot as they grow. Very good. Very good job. Very good job. You know, I'm sure there's going to be more. But excellent job. Very glad and happy for our sister. Okay? Again, you know, when you give me something that I can either build a relevant lesson around or make a suggestion, you know, you got to know I might be slow, but I'm for show. So, you know, I've been working all day to day, getting together some more lessons to bring forth. Sometime tomorrow, I gotta get some rest. So, I love you, and I thank you all. I ask that you all be blessed. And, you know, you can keep your suggestion coming, but don't be upset if I don't jump and let the next video be what you suggest. But this was all relevant, and it fell in line with what we had been looking at in our series on the family. And so, you know, we have to let the Holy Spirit lead, but this definitely fell in line. And when the suggestion was made, I knew that this was the final installment, and this was the cherry on top that I would need. So, again, I'm very thankful. Very thankful for the sister. Let's look at this conclusion, and then we're going to pray our way out of here. My conclusion, what I found from reading about the pineal gland and babies, is that while babies are still very young and don't have the ability to talk, communicate properly yet, they still have the ability to use their soul. Since the soul is developed while in the womb of the mother, they can use their soul to the best of their ability because they're very sensitive and can feel things. Hence the, well, play some music for it. Well, I can tell my baby mad in there. I've heard women say it before. I'm like, how you know the baby mad? What is it, a Wi-Fi link from your belly to your ear? I don't see no cords or nothing. It's got to be Wi-Fi. But, you know, we overstand it now. There is a cord, the umbilical cord. And it is like a wire for the human body machine. The Holy Spirit is strong and can be felt by babies more so than adults because their soul has not been altered or calcified by means of chemicals, poisons, vaccines, poor nutrition, etc. Beautifully said. Okay, and that's why breast milk helps babies a lot as they grow. So, again, we look at the order of the true and living Creator. He sets all things in order. He sets the crooked things straight. And so, the video is the baby at church getting Holy Spirit. Okay? It'll bless you to see something glorifying the mysteries and supernatural operations of the Most High, true and living Creator. Bashama Mashiach Yahavasha, Ahaya Abaya, Kwata Elaya, Toda Abaya Hava. I just ask right now the authority in the name of Jesus, by His stripes, by the nails, by the thorns, and by the blood of Jesus, Heavenly Father, that You protect all who listen and watch in Jesus' name, that You loose their own personal warrior angels to be as their bodyguards, to walk with them, to talk with them, minister to them, to be at their right, left, front, back, overhead, and under their feet, Heavenly Father, to protect them from attack fully. Let them be in a protective hedge in the authority of the name of Jesus. And I ask that You cover them with a protective covering in the authority of the name of Jesus, and that there be nothing lacking, nothing missing, nothing broken in their lives. Heavenly Father, I speak restoration in the authority of the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, restoration, Heavenly Father, even of their very soul. Psalm 23, You shall restore their souls. And Heavenly Father, in the authority of the name of Jesus, by the stripes of Jesus, by His nails, by His thorns, and by the blood of Jesus, Father, we also ask that these, any unclean spirits, any negative entities, negative energies, demonic strongholds, demonic contracts, ancestral demon spirits, or ancestral familial or familiar spirits. I ask in the authority of the name of Jesus right now that you loose a host of heavenly angels to come down and to snatch each one of them out and to bind them up in the authority of the name of Jesus and to cast each one of them down to the pit of the abyss, the dungeon of the dragon, or wherever Jesus would have them to go, including the place of Tartarus. And Father, I ask in the authority of the name of Jesus that you bind to all who listen, Heavenly Father, the prosperity in Jesus' name that has been promised to you throughout your book, in Jesus' name, throughout your Holy Spirit filled book, in Jesus' name, Heavenly Father, whom the Lord sets free is free indeed. And Heavenly Father, I know that you will, that none are free, that none are bound to any form of bondage whatsoever, in the authority of the name of Jesus, that all chains are broken in Jesus' name, except for the chains, Heavenly Father, that are soaked in the blood of Jesus, that keep us connected, Heavenly Father, to you and one with another. And so we just ask in the authority and name of Jesus for every sister, for every brother that listens right now, that is touching and agreeing right now, Heavenly Father, that you extend your great favor, Heavenly Father, in every aspect of their lives. In the authority of the name of Jesus, we've decreed we touch in agreement. Guess what? Therefore, we shall receive it. It is so and it is done. Love you so much. This is Unplugem. I'll be back with the irregularly scheduled deprogramming. Why?